नीचे लैपटॉप में। शैल वी स्टार्ट?
यस
हेलो एवरीवन, अ वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू ग्लोबल एसोसिएशन फॉर फिजियोथेरेपी। मायसेल्फ डॉक्टर किरण कुमारी, होस्ट मॉडरेटर फॉर टुडेज वेबिनार। आई एम होल्डिंग पोस्ट ऑफ सेक्रेटरी इन बिहार वुमेन्स विंग जीएपीटी। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू हैव अ वेबिनार ऑन डायबिटिक फूड। स्पीकर फॉर टुडेज वेबिनार इज डॉक्टर डिम्पल हर्ष मोदी, who is vice president in Maharashtra Women's Wing GAPT. She has done her masters in neuro, practicing since 10 years, previously working in CHL Apollo Indore for 3 years, then assistant professor in RD Gardi Medical College Ujjain for 2 years, and after that she settled in Mumbai, running clinic with name Swasth Health since 7 years in Dahisar, Mumbai. I would like to mention here our organizing committee: Dr. Sita Singh, National President in Women's Wing GAPT; Dr. Akanksha, National Vice President in Women's Wing GAPT; Dr. Sneha Saran, General Secretary in Bihar Women's Wing GAPT; Dr. Akriti Kumari, Joint Secretary in Bihar Women's Wing GAPT; Dr. Alka Kumari, Treasurer in Bihar Women's Wing GAPT; Dr. Anjana Kumari, Executive Member in Bihar Women's Wing GAPT. Now I would like to welcome Dr. Dimple Harsh Modi to start with the session. Participants are requested to keep their mic and video off to avoid technical issues, and don't download the session. We are uploading this recording in YouTube channel of GAPT. I request Dr. Dimple ma'am, please start.
Thank you, Dr. Kiran, for the kind introduction. So we shall start with the diabetic foot topic. It is a very keen and interesting topic. Nobody cares for foot and diabetic, so special care has to be taken in diabetic foot, and what special care as a physio you can take will go through it. So welcome to the webinar on the diabetic foot. So you already know there is a lot to manage if you have diabetes: checking your blood sugar, making healthy food, finding time to be active, taking medicines, going to doctor's appointment. With all that, feet might be the last thing you keep it in mind, but daily care is of the one of the best ways to prevent foot complications. As we know that about half of all people with diabetes have some kind of the nerve damage. You can have nerve damage in any part of the body, but nerves in your feet are the most commonly affected, and nerve damage can also cause the loss of feeling in your foot. That means there is no feeling of pain, or if there is any tingling or numbness in your leg, you don't feel anything. Some people with nerve damage have numbness, tingling or pain, but others may have also no symptoms. Nerve damage can also lower your ability to feel the pain, heat or cold. Living without pain, it sounds very good, but it comes at a very high cost. Pain in the body is way of telling you something is going wrong in your body, and you have to take care of that thing. If there is pain in your neck, if there is pain in your hands, it gives a signal to your body that something is going wrong. So you should take care of that. What is creating difficulty, and what is creating that pain? If you don't feel pain in your feet, you may not notice any cut or a blister or a sore or any other problem. Some problem can become very serious if they aren't treated early. So diabetic foot care is of utmost importance. Now, so So, what is a diabetic foot? A foot with a constellation of the pathologic conditions affecting the lower extremity in diabetes, often leading to amputation or death due to complication. This common initial lesion leading to amputation in a non-healing skin ulcer, or induced by regional pressure, which is pathogenically linked to sensory neuropathy, ischemia or infection. If all the threes are connected and it creates a pressure, so it will create a non-skin, non-healing skin ulcer, and which can, if not treated correctly, it can often lead to amputation or death. So how does diabetes occur? This all happens, how diabetes happens in very short words, I can tell you how your body makes or uses insulin. And if the mechanism gets disturbed, then diabetes happens. Insulin moves blood sugar to cell where it is stored and it is later used for energy. If it is not stored and it is not used for energy, then increase in the blood sugar happens. Okay, so all the blood sugar is deposited in the bloodstream, and that causes hyperglycemia. That can be seen in your blood sugar reports. So there are two types of diabetes: type 1, that is insulin dependent diabetes mellitus, and type 2, that is non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. When the metabolism of the glucose gets disturbed, and this causes diabetes. What happens in type 2 diabetes? When the fat, liver, or the muscle does not respond to the insulin, it becomes insulin resistance. And as I said, it is not absorbed by the cell. It is all collected in the bloodstream, and hyperglycemia occurs. So what is the extent of diabetes mellitus in India? Almost 20 million diabetes mellitus patients in India there are. Diabetes mellitus is the largest cause of neuropathy, and half of the people don't know because they don't go for the regular checkup. Foot ulceration is the most common cause of hospital admissions for diabetes. It is very expensive to treat and may even lead to amputation and need for chronic institutionalized care. After amputation, 30% lose other limb in 3 years. After amputation, 2/3 die in 5 years. Type 2 is very worse. 15% of the diabetic may develop a foot ulcer. So what is the pathology, physiology behind this? There may be vascular cause. It can be neuropathy, which can be sensory, motor, or autonomic. So what is the neuropathy? If there are changes in the vasonervosum, which results in ischemia. What is a vasonervosum? It is a thin arteries that helps in the nutrition supply to the main arteries, nerves. So it probably gives more nutrition to the nerves. So if there are changes in the vasonervosum layer, so it causes ischemia. It does not supply that nutrients to the main nerves. So it may be due to increased sorbitol in the feeding vessels, which creates a back block flow and causes nerve ischemia. Intraneural accumulation of advanced products of glycolation that you have studied in biochemistry. It is also called as the distal symmetric peripheral neuropathy. Abnormalities of all three neurologic symptoms contribute to the ulceration. It affects the feet and legs first, followed by the hands and arms. Signs and symptoms of the peripheral neuropathy are often worse at night. At night, most of the diabetic patients are unable to sleep because of the tingling, numbness, burning sensation, extreme burning sensations, like there is some heat kind of thing in your legs. So they are unable to sleep at night. So what does it include? Numbness or reduced ability to feel the pain or the temperature, tingling or burning sensation, sharp pains or cramps, increased sensitivity to touch for some people. Even a bedsheet's weight can be painful. So you can think of that, how much the diabetic pain is very painful to the patient. Serious foot problems such as ulcers, infections, and bone and joint pain. So other cause may be, which happens in diabetes, that may be vascular disease. It is 30 times more prevalent in diabetics. Diabetics get atherosclerosis obliterans or lead pipe arteries. There is a blockage, calcification of the tuna medica. Tuna medica is the middle layer. Endothelial changes. If there is an often increased blood flow with a lack of elastic properties of the arterioles. So what is autonomic neuropathy? Autonomic neuropathy, what happens in that? The autonomic nervous system helps in the regulation of the sweating and perfusion of the limb. If it gets affected, the patient will not be able to feel the warmth or sweating, all these problems. So it there causes a loss of autonomic control and inhibits the thermoregulatory function in sweating. So it results in the dry, scaly and stiff skin that is more prone to cracking and allows a portal of entry for the bacteria. The autonomic nervous system controls your heart, bladder, stomach, intestine, sex organs and eyes. Diabetes can affect nerves in any of these areas, possibly causing a lack of awareness that blood sugar levels are low. So there is a hypoglycemia unawareness. Bladder or bowel problems, diabetic people are more prone to have frequent urination, slow stomach emptying, gastroparesis, causing nausea, vomiting and loss of appetite. Changes in the way your eyes adjust from light to dark, decreased sexual response. So you can see the how the autonomic neuropathy of foot may be looked like. It will be very dry and no moisture. It will be very, the skin may be very thick and easily you can move, remove the skin or the blister with your hand. So it's very painful also sometimes. Proximal neuropathy. It's also called as the diabetic polyradiculopathy. This type of neuropathy often affects the nerves in thighs, hips, buttocks and legs. It can also affect the abdominal and chest areas. Symptoms are usually on one side of the body but may spread to the other side. So what patient may feel, there may be severe pain in the hip and the thigh or the buttock, eventual weakness or shrinking of the thigh muscles, difficulty rising from a sitting position. Patients are unable to stand or find very difficulty in from sitting to standing position, severe stomach ache. Other form of neuropathy is the mononeuropathy. There are two types of mononeuropathy. It can be cranial and peripheral. Mononeuropathy refers to a damage to a specific nerve. It may also lead to difficulty focusing or double vision, aching behind one eye, paralysis on one side of the body, that is called as a Bell's palsy, tingling and numbness in your hands or fingers except your little finger, weakness in your hand that may cause to drop things. There will be so much weakness in your hand that you are not able to hold the heavy things. Sometimes lighter things also may fall from your hand. So what happens in motor neuropathy? If mostly there are ulcerations in the forefoot, there can be intrinsic muscle wasting, causes clawfoot and equinus contracture. Sensory neuropathy. It is a loss of protective sensation. You don't feel any heat or cold or any pinching sensation. So if that sensation is lost, so you can see, you can think how it must be. If you don't feel that, if something is hot on your hand and it will eventually burn. So if there is a loss of protective sensation, the patient suffers so much like they are easily blisters, sore formation. Okay, it may even lead to bleeding also, and patient doesn't realize that there is bleeding. So it starts distally and migrates proximally in a stocking distribution. So if there is a loss of large fiber loss, there may be with this, it loses, the patient loses the sensation of the light touch and the proprioception. If there is a small fiber loss, the patient loses the sensation of the pain and temperature. Or patient may have both the fiber loss also, small and large fiber loss also. So two types of mechanisms in ulcerations are there. Unacceptable stress and acceptable stress. Unacceptable stress, what can be that? The patient is not able to realize. If there is a rock in your shoe or glass pinching in your foot, if there is a burning sensation, and unacceptable maybe if the shoes are not proper, the heels are not proper, the heels are all rubbed from one side, medial side or lateral side, or there may be deformity in your foot. So the most important thing you should, when the patient comes to your clinic, that if are the diabetic people is having a charcoal foot type of problem or not. So what is charcoal foot? Charcoal foot is a serious complication which can affect persons with peripheral neuropathy, especially those with diabetes mellitus. This is a combination in which the nerves in the lower legs and the feet have been damaged. The damage causes a lot of loss of sensation in the feet. It affects the bones, joints, and soft tissues of the foot and ankle. The bones may become weak and can break. It has to be treated as early as possible, or else the joints in the foot collapse and foot eventually becomes deformed, causing pressure sores. It can often lead to rocker foot deformity. An open wound with foot deformity can even lead to infection and ultimately can result in amputation. So you can see how it is the normal foot and the charcoal foot. The structure of the foot is all disorganized. The arches are all diminished. It is coming, the midfoot is all coming downside. It has become, the sole of the foot has become all flat and there is no arch in that. So what are the symptoms? If there is swelling or redness of the foot or ankle, skin feeling warmer at the point of injury, if there is a deep aching feeling, deformation of the foot. So what are the causes of the charcoal foot? There are no specific causes, but in these people, it has been found that there is a charcoal foot. It may be due to alcohol or drug abuse, an infection, spinal cord injury or disease, Parkinson's disease, HIV, syphilis. So charcoal foot is in, it is divided into stages, stage 1, stage 2 and stage 3. In stage 1, there is a maximum destruction, or can be said as the fragmentation. It is an acute stage which is characterized by the redness, swelling, warmth of the foot and ankle. Internally, the soft tissue swelling and small bone fractures are started to occur. The result is destruction of the joints and surrounding bone. This causes the joints to lose the stability, resulting in dislocation. The bones may even jellify. There is a softening of the bone, rocker foot, rocker bottom foot deformity, bony foot protrusions. If not treated, this stage can last for up to 1 year. Okay, so you can see what are the destruction. It happens in the stage 1. And one more thing I want to explain you, what is the rocker bottom foot deformity. In this, the arch becomes everted and it creates a very dangerous pressure around the midfoot, and the forefoot gets dorsiflexed and hind foot gets plantar flexed. So you can understand how the structure may be. Okay, if the forefoot is dorsiflexed and the midfoot is plantar flexed, so it creates the arch of the foot gets fully diminished, or you can say there is no arch at all. So now we come to the second stage. The body attempts to heal the damage done during the first stage. Destruction of the joints and bones slows down, resulting in less swelling, redness and warmth. Now the third stage, it is the final stage in which the joints and bones of the foot heal. Unfortunately, if they do not go back to the original condition or shape of their own, while no further damage has been done to the foot, it is often left as deformed or in unstable condition. The foot may also be more prone to the formation of sores and ulcers, which might lead to further deformity, or in some cases, it will lead to amputation also. So stage-wise, you have to take care. If the patient is coming in stage 1, so what special care you have to give to the patient? So there is no further damage or no increase in the damage. If the damage is small, you can easily manage the stage 2 and stage 3 is going to come. But you have to, if the patient comes to you in stage 1, you have to accurately diagnose the condition. And you have to give proper precautions and what are the safety measures to the patient so the further destruction and can be managed easily. So how you can diagnose the condition? At early stages, it may be difficult to diagnose the charcoal foot since the X-ray and lab test are normal. But in later stages, you can reveal there are small fractures, bone fractures or dislocation. or you can see the change in the shape or the alignment of the foot. As I already told you, there may be plantar flexion or dorsiflexion at the forefoot, and hind foot is plantar flex, or the arch is already fully diminished. So you can see all these changes in the x-rays. So what are the other tests you can do? So first one is the Simmons-Winston test. It is the monofilament test. There is a monofilament, you can see the card and very thin needle. So when you press it to the dorsum of the foot, the great toe or the other toes, the midfoot, hind foot, when you touch it, the needle is so light and very, very, very thin that it generally folds. If the needle is like this, it will generally bend like this. And patient has to tell, does the patient is feeling that pressure or touch or not. The other test is pinprick test. In this, what is the difference between the monofilament and the pinprick? The monofilament is very thin needle, and in the pinprick, it is the needle is compared to the monofilament is little thick. So other test is the neurometer test. It is generally the reflexes testing, how we do the electrodiagnosis. Then we can do the tendon reflexes to check the muscle tone and strength of the leg and foot muscles. So now we come to the assessment, which is the most important thing. If the patient comes to your clinic, what you have to examine. So if the symptoms can be checked very early and can be managed in a better way to if it can help the patient to get from the further damage, which can ultimately lead to amputation or more medications or more expensive treatment. So we can stop at that level if it is diagnosed properly. So what all things you have to keep it in mind while doing the assessment. So listen properly, because it is the most important thing. So what things you have to first notice. If there is an impaired sensation, which may be due to neuropathy. If there is an impaired blood supply, which can be due to peripheral artery disease. If there is an impaired wound healing or secondary infections, that also has to be kept in mind. And if the patient is with impaired mobility of chronically ill diabetic, so all these things you have to see, whether there is an impaired sensation or the blood supply or the wound healing, or there is a mobility problem when you analyze the gait of the patient. So what three major components you should see when the patient comes to you? So what you should do, first the inspection, then the assessment of the vascular supply, and then the neurologic function. So in inspection, what you have to do? Firstly, expose both the legs of the patient above knees. Okay, when your patient comes to your clinic, you have to expose till the knee so you can look after all the things properly. Then if there are amputations, so you have to see all the things, how amputation has been done, at what level it has done, and how is the scar formation. Okay, the patient is still feeling any numbness or tingling in that amputated area. And assess the general foot hygiene. You have to, very keen observation has to be done on the foot hygiene. Is the skin dry, scaly, or it is very rough? There are corns or calluses in the formation in the foot. Okay. And other than that, you have to see the hair pattern also. If there is an asymmetric hair pattern, it indicates there may be arterial insufficiency. And look for the foot deformities also. Foot deformities in check the arc of the foot. Okay, there may be metatarsal subluxation, there may be claw foot or hammer toe, or there may be neuropathic orthopathy that I have already explained you, that is a charcot foot. If there is a metatarsal subluxation, there may be bunion formation at the greater toe. If there is a claw toe or hammer toe, there may be vertical subluxation of the MTP, PIP, or the DIP joints. And lastly, you have to see his shoes also. What kind of shoes he is wearing? They're very hard. How is the heel? How is the sole of the foot? How is the inner sole of the shoe? Okay, all these things you have to see. Then you have to check the vascular supply. How you can see the vascular supply of the foot? First, you have to assess the temperature. of the foot by placing your hand, the dorsum of the hand on that area. Assess the capillary refilling. Capillary refilling, how you can do? Press the nail of the GT and press it for a few seconds, and when you release it, and check that in how many seconds the filling, refilling occurs. You will find that the pinkish sensation should come very soon. Okay. Then you have to assess the distal pulses, distal pulses, proximal pulses, and the popliteal pulse. And distal pulse, what you have to see? Where you have to check? To the greater two, extensor tendon. Extensor tendon, laterally you have to press your, keep your two fingers there, right, and gently press. You will feel that sensation. If you don't feel that sensation or it is very diminished, then go for the proximal pulses. Proximal pulses can be seen to the medial malleolus, inferiorly. Okay. And then lastly, popliteal pulse. Popliteal pulse is felt midline in the popliteal fossa. So how you have to keep your hand position in that? If it is a knee joint, you have to around this, you have to keep your hand like this, and you have to press your fingers backside in the middle of the popliteal fossa, backside like this. You have to feel like this, okay? But the hand should be around the joint, knee joint, okay? In that, you have to keep the knee in moderate flexion. And lastly, you have to check the venous refilling also. That is done by photoplethysmography. So if you are checking the pulse, there is no numerical scale. So it is just assessed qualitatively. So you can feel there is no pulsation that may be absent or present but diminished, normal or bounding. And then you have to check the ankle brachial index also. Okay. So this all things you have to check. So you understood all this? Okay, then we come to the neurological testing. In neurological testing, what you have to see? Neurological is mainly concerned with the proprioception. Okay, proprioception, sensation, all this you have to check. So first we'll check the sensation. In sensation first, then we'll check the vibration. Vibration, how you can check? With the tuning fork. Okay, then proprioception. Proprioception, how you can check? Keep your ground, make your greater toe up and down with the eyes closed. Ask the patient to close his eyes and tell him to move the greater toe, and you will move the patient's greater toe up and down. If patient is able to recognize, then it means the proprioception is intact. Then the monofilament test that I've already explained you, it has to be done at the greater toe or MTP joint and little toe, okay, forefoot, all this you have to check. Then pain, how the pain is there. How patient is feeling, it is a deep pain or the superficial pain. And the ankle reflex. Ankle reflex, how you have to check in diabetic patients so the patient is more comfortable and you get the reflex correctly. So what you have to do, you have to make the patient lie supine with hip in external rotation, knee little bit in flexion and ankle in dorsiflex position. So it stretches the ankle Achilles tendon. In that you have to check then the ankle reflex. You will get a very good reflex. So you will be able to judge the reflex correctly. And then lastly, you have to see the gait pattern also of the patient. So all these things you have to keep it in mind while assessing the diabetic foot. So now in short, let's see. Clinical examination, history, general, you have to see what you have to see in that. Medications, diseases, what all medications the patient is taking, okay, and how many times and then how many years the medications have been continued. Okay, then diseases, cardiovascular risk factors, what are his work profile, what are the hobbies, what are the lifestyle, how is sedentary lifestyle or sitting or is standing or field work, you have to ask all for that. Then diabetic symptoms and complications. And then you have to go with the foot specific, the risk factor information about the present ulcer, duration, treatment, and etiology. Okay. So all this foot specific should be very, very, very specific. Because if you take the precise history, the management becomes more easy and very correct. So you have to be very specific. Since how many long the disease has been there, what treatment you have taken, what medications you have taken, for how many years you've been under the insulin, or what was the cause when you diagnosed with the diabetic condition. So all things, and when you did your last report of diabetes, all things to be asked very specifically. And in inspection, at least once in a year. American Diabetic Association, their organization says that diabetic patients should have their inspection twice a year. But in here, we can say that at least once a year, it is most important to have your inspection. If it is done twice, it is very great. But at least once a year, you should go for the diabetic foot checkup. So this I have already explained you. Vascular, dorsalis pedis pulse, tibialis posterior pulse, then popliteal pulse, venous refilling, foot appearance. Okay, all this you have to see. Then Wilston monofilament test, vibration with the 128 hertz tuning fork, pinpricks discrimination, Achilles tendon reflexes, and if there are any foot deformities on bony prominences, that you have to look after for that. If there is any ulcer, look for the perfusion, extent and size, infection. So if there is an infection, what you have to see is there is any purulent secretion, or there is a redness or warmth or swelling or pain, delayed healing or bad odor. Systemic signs, you have to see the fever, what is the general condition of the patient, increased exudation in the ulcer, all you have to things you have to keep it in mind. X-rays to determine the presence of the foreign bodies, gas, osteomyelitis, osteolysis or joint effusion. And MRI and bone scan and CT scan be done to see what extent of infection is there, whether it is only muscular or it has reached to the bones also. Okay, and then non-invasive vascular studies, you can study the ankle pressure, ankle brachial systolic pressure index, okay, toe pressures, vascular imaging, subtalar range of motion. So what all assessment you have to do in a diabetic foot, or if there is any amputated stump assessment you have to do. So you have to go for the observation also, sensory also, autonomic also, and the vascular also. In observation, you will see the color, ulcer, edema, if there is any deformity. Sensory, I have already explained you, the pain, paresthesia, monofilament test, light touch, okay, joints in position change. Autonomic, if there is any, how is the skin texture and the temperature, okay. There is a irregular pulse, you have to see the dorsalis pedis, okay, then tibialis, and then popliteal. How is the vascular refilling? All things you have to see, and exact remark or the findings, you have to write it down. And whenever the patient comes again, you have to compare what are the changes. So you can see how is the foot, maybe in starting, how you feel the diabetic foot. Okay, you have to see the plantar aspect also and the dorsal aspect also. So what are the management and interventions? So in physical therapy, what all things you can do? Okay, the physical therapists are mostly involved in the prevention and management of the diabetic foot complications. This is done by gait, posture, foot offloading, education and training. All this education you have to provide to the patient. And you have to work in combination with the medical and physiotherapy. So physical therapy alone will not work. You have to work in a team. So if there are any ankle or foot arthropathies, that medical management and the physiotherapy management has to be done. What physical activity a patient can do in diabetes, that also you have to advise to the patient. What are the diabetic foot care and management, that also you have to advise to the patient. If there are diabetic neuropathy, what all things you have to explain to the patient, and what intervention has to be done, that has to be properly explained to the patient. The physical therapist is also involved in the rehabilitation process after an amputation. So what all things you will explain to the patient? The patient education is the utmost important, because the patient will come to you and you will assist the patient or give advice for 1 hour. But after that, the patient is at home. So all things the patient should care if it is explained properly. So what first thing you have to tell to the patient, you have to inspect your feet properly. There, check for the cuts, blisters, redness, swelling, or nail problems. That has to be informed to the doctor if they notice any changes. Or tell the patient to write, make a diary. So it has been very clearly mentioned how it happened, what was the incident. If the patient writes in his own words, and we'll be able to manage the condition properly. Bathe feet with lukewarm water. Wash feet by using a soft washcloth or sponge. Dry by blotting or patting, and carefully dry between the toes also. If it is not dry between the toes, it can cause fungal infection also. Moisturize your feet, but not between toes, as it may cause fungal infection. Cut nails carefully. Never treat corns or calluses yourself. Tell the patient very specifically that they should not tear or with scissor. Many patients cut the corns or the calluses with scissors or blades also. So tell them very clearly it has not to be done at home. Wear clean, dry socks and change them daily. Wear socks to beds. Shake out of your shoes and feel them in whether there is something in foreign body or rock or something is there inside the shoe. Keep your feet warm and dry. Consider using an antiperspirant on soles. Never walk barefoot. Keep blood sugar levels under control. Do not smoke. Get periodic foot examinations. Diabetes complications and amputation prevention. Shoes and orthotics for diabetics. That is also very important. In 2009, the evidence there was an evidence-based literature review done, and it was told that TENS might be more effective for pain treatment in diabetic neuropathy. In 2008, 30 neuropathic diabetic patients were taken in that multidisciplinary approach. Physical therapy plays a very important role in diabetic neuropathic patients. So, what they have done in that 12 weeks session? Low-level laser irradiation for 10 to 15 minutes per session on an ulcer. Laser biostimulation on the peroneal nerve trunk. Specific dorsiflexion and the ankle range of motion exercises and strengthening exercises. And education on the foot care and home exercises. So what all medical management can be done? Diabetic wound care management. Antibiotic treatment that is given by the doctor. Hospitalization if required, or immobilization, or IV antibiotics. Okay, so that has to be taken care also. So urgent surgery is indicated if the infection is accompanied by a deep abscess or extensive bone or joint involvement, crepitus, substantial necrosis or gangrene, or necrotizing fasciitis. It was told by one of the scientists that if surgical intervention is required for moderate or severe infection, is likely to decrease the risk of major amputation. Okay, so lastly, I would like to tell you the diabetic foot clinic. So the physiotherapy is not only linked with the, we have seen the ortho clinics, neuro clinics, gynec clinics, cardio clinics, but now diabetic foot clinic is the new branch evolving because diabetes is now becoming one of the major top one disease of the world. More of the patients are suffering from diabetes. So diabetic foot clinic is of utmost importance. So it will be, this lecture is not only about for the awareness, but this lecture was also for the people who wanted to work very in a different way. I can say that you have to go in a very different field. So diabetic foot clinic will be a very important role it will play to set up of your clinic. So it has to be done in an integration form with a diabetic doctor, physiotherapist, occupational therapist, orthotist, or podiatrist, all who will work in one team and will be very helpful for the patient also. It will give you a full rehabilitation to the patient suffering from diabetes. And we can save the patient from any further infections, okay, if we work in a team, okay? So that's all about this session. So I hope you like this session. Thank you very much.